that it feels good to support them and all the great things they're doing. Just want to mention a couple things about our schedule. Today we will have the Zoom meeting at 11:30. After the worship service today, we're going to have a question and answer period, and that will not be on Facebook, so you can ask your questions of Donna, our speaker, and if that's not finished by 11:30, we'll just keep going, but we'll get the Zoom up when we're ready. And I also wanted to mention the church council meeting tomorrow evening. You might have seen the clip bags out there in the middle room. The children are receiving these activity bags this weekend because we can't meet in person. The theme this week is Jesus is Nuts About Me. Isn't that wonderful? So that ministry is going on so the children can learn that God loves them and what it means to be people of faith and hope. Just one other thing I want to mention is about our first hymn today, which we'll just be listening to since we can't sing. I chose it because the words are so beautiful, and you probably don't know it. And one of the things about us not being able to sing the hymns and we're just listening is I've seen the opportunity to listen to some new ones that might be hard for us to sing if we're trying to sing it. This one was actually written by a person from Vietnam, so it's beautiful words. When the time comes, you can look at the words in the hymnal. And so I hope you'll enjoy that and it will contribute to your meditation and worship of God today. I think it's a beautiful one. Okay, then we will continue with our worship now.
Let us pray. Creator, we give you thanks for all that you are and all that you bring to us within your creation. In Jesus, you place your gospel in the center of the sacred circle through which all creation is related. You show us the way to live a generous and compassionate life. Give us your strength to live together with respect and commitment as we grow in your spirit. For you are God, now and forever. Amen. Our opening hymn is number 498, My Prayer Rises to Heaven.
Thank you.
signs of peace, and if you have a prayer request, you can bring it up and put it in the basket up front here. Please join me in the confession. When we look at history honestly, we understand that we, as primarily white Christians, have caused a great deal of harm for Native Americans. There's been a terrible and brutal history of violence and oppression toward indigenous peoples of North America. Columbus and those who followed were obsessed with conversion, brought over disease the natives had no way to cure, and ultimately desecrated entire peoples and cultures. Today, we want to acknowledge this history. We want to be honest about the ways our faith tradition has been used to colonize, to abuse, and to oppress people. And we seek to proclaim the truth of the gospel, that Christ came to love and to serve, not to conquer and enslave. Let us open our hearts and begin our worship with confession. O Great Spirit, God of every people and every tribe, we come to you as your many children to ask for your forgiveness and guidance. Forgive us for the colonialism that stains our past, the ignorance that allowed us to think that we could claim another's home for our own. Heal us of this history. Remind us that none of us were discovered, since none of us were lost, but that we all gathered within the sacred circle of your community. Guide us through your wisdom to restore the truth of our heritage. Help us to confront the racism that divides us as we confess the pain it has caused to the human family. Call us to kinship, mend the root of our hearts, and let us live in justice and peace through Jesus Christ, the one who came that all people might live in new dignity. Amen. And now our responsive reading is Psalm 90, verses 1 to 12, page 809 in the hymnal. And it goes on to the second page. Lord, you have been our dwelling place in all generations.
Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever you have formed the earth of the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God.
You turn us back to the dust and say, turn back, O mortal ones.
For a thousand years in your sight are but as yesterday and as night, or as a watch in the night.
You sweep them away. They are like a dream, like grass which is renewed in the morning.
In the morning it flourishes and is renewed.
For we are consumed by your anger, by your wrath we are overwhelmed.
You have set our iniquities before you, and our secret sins in the light of your countenance.
For all our days pass away under your wrath, our years come to an end like a sigh.
The years of our life are 80 and 10, or even by reason of strength 40. Sin is your hand. They are soon gone, and we fly away.
Who considers the power of your anger, the awesomeness of your wrath?
So teach us the number of our days, that we may receive our wisdom.
Return, O Lord, how long? Have pity on your servants.
Satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days.
Make us glad as many days as you have afflicted us, and as many years as we have seen evil.
Let your
our God be upon us, and establish the work of our hands.
Yes, establish the work of our hands.
The New Testament reading is Romans 12, verses 15 to 17. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. Here ends the reading of the Gospel. And today we are blessed to have a Native American woman here to teach us something. Donna Fan Boyle is Choctaw Cherokee. She's the mother of two sons and has devoted her life to caring for the young and the elderly. She cares for all aspects of nature, raises organic honeybees and free-range chickens for eggs. 8 years ago, she alerted the Neshaminy School District that using the R word for their sports mascot was a damaging racial slur, the same word that the Washington football team used to use. Both her sons attended that high school. She was confident they would cease and desist. Instead, the district has spent $500,000 defending their right to keep a symbol that denigrates indigenous people. Today, Donna continues to work for eliminating the Neshaminy's and all schools' racist mascots. Inspired by her courage, CNA formed a coalition of natives and allies to support this quest by getting rid of Pennsylvania, racist sports mascots, and to promote the education of accurate Native American history. Donna is a member in good standing with the American Indian Movement Central Texas chapter, as well as Indigenous 215. Thank you, Donna, for coming.
Doing something wrong when I take my mask off.
Right.
Good morning.
Good morning.
And thank you for giving me this time and space during Native American Heritage Month to share with you these very important facts about how Native mascotry is so intertwined with Native equality. Mascots are a way in which Native peoples are systematically discriminated against. Race-based Native mascotry in sports and schools provokes people to dress up, paint up, wear fake war bonnets, mock Native song and dance, in other words, to play Indian. Wearing red face at school sporting events is racial discrimination and is the equivalent of wearing blackface. Both of these are dehumanizing acts based on degrading stereotypes. In many ways, the dehumanization of Native people on the playing field gets reflected in the high rates of death of Native people at the hands of police, among the highest in the country. Also, most people are not aware that in this country, every year, more than 500 Native women go murdered or missing, and yet the majority of those cases do not get investigated. Murdered and missing Indigenous women is a real issue in Native country, and the red dress is a symbol of that. Some of my friends have even written up statement saying that if I go missing, it's not by my own will, because, you know, if we go missing, we want people to look for us. Murder is the third leading cause of death among Native American women. One in three Native women have been raped or experienced attempted rape, and 84% of Native women have experienced physical, sexual, or psychological violence in their lifetime. Personally, I myself have had numerous incidents starting from the time I was a young child where I've been degraded, spoken down to, and objectified. I remember growing up during the Vietnam War era. At that time, many Americans hated anyone who looked Asian. Since many Americans didn't or don't know that Natives still exist except in fairy tales, they assumed by our appearance that we must be something else, some other race. There were times that I was called the racist slurs, gook, chink, and non-baby by ignorant people who assumed that I was their enemy, but I was just a little girl. I believe that this was the beginning of my call to activism. Throughout growing up, I received mixed negative messages. While I was seen as the enemy by some, others, especially men, viewed me as exotic and took abusive liberties to make explicit innuendos and uninvited physical advances and outright physical attacks. In 1995, I was on my job delivering auto parts to one of the regular customers, and this man always made inappropriate remarks. He would call me squaw or sexy Indian chick or, you know, something to that, you know, like that. And he would make physical advances, which I always avoided. But this time he got physical. He grabbed me by my hair so fast that I couldn't run. There were four of his buddies in the garage who saw what was happening. I fought him off. I told him that I was expected back at the store and that if I didn't go right back, that they would know something happened to me. The other guys persuaded him to let me go or he might get in trouble. In my mind, I was fighting for my life. I didn't know how it would end, but luckily I was able to leave. I was so shaken by what took place. Native women and Native people in general face abusive treatment because of misconceptions and negative stereotypes of who we are. That incident changed my life, you know, changed my behavior forever. I can't count how many times I've been called Pocahontas by people who only know of her as a fairy tale character. But the true story of Pocahontas was no Disney fairy tale, and it's not one which you would want to tell your children at bedtime. Pocahontas wasn't even her real name. Most kids learn the story of Pocahontas as the young Native American girl who threw herself on Captain Smith to save his life from her father's rage and jealousy, then fell rapturously in love despite an age and cultural difference as wide as the Atlantic Ocean, but lived happily ever after in history books, bedtime tales, and gorgeous Disney movies. But that is not the truth. For starters, her name was Matoka, the daughter of Chief Powhatan. She was given the nickname of Pocahontas, which means playful one, for her mischievous nature. It's believed Pocahontas was about 10 years old at the time, whereas Smith was in his late 20s. So, Pocahontas likely did not fall madly in love with a man more than twice her age, especially at 10 years old. Pocahontas eventually married a fellow tribesman named Pocum, with whom she had a son. Pocahontas was lured aboard a British ship headed for England in 1613 and held hostage. By 1614, she was baptized into the Anglican Church with the name Rebecca and reluctantly married John Rolfe. They had a son, Thomas. The following year, they had the son. Early in 1617, she was set to return to the colonies, but instead remained in Gravesend, England, suffering from unknown illnesses, dying at roughly the age of 21. Her father died shortly thereafter. This is quite the sad truth, far differing from that happy myth that children have been told for decades. You see, dehumanization begins from the bottom up, and it begins when people whitewash the true horrific facts and treat entire communities as nothing more than mascots or savages. It's these transgressions that serve as the foundation for violent crimes against Native people. The refusal to acknowledge Native Americans as people is nothing new. The moment that white European settlers convinced themselves that they discovered this country centuries ago, they also established different places of human beings. Today, every sports fan wearing a t-shirt emblazoned with a huge red face, and every team with the name Indians, Chiefs, Redskins, Savages, and yes, Warriors, etc., reinforces that dehumanization. These may seem like harmless offenses, but they're actually cogs in a constantly churning racist machine that fuels Native erasure. Native Americans already struggle with visibility, as we only make up 1.3% of the United States population. When our identity is whittled down to a night at a football game or a day of dress up, a distinction is silently made that we are lesser people. The dehumanization of Native Americans occurs so frequently that nobody blinks when Party City sets up its Cowboys and Indians section each October. As the dehumanization is normalized, we as Indigenous people become voiceless, merely seen as a joke, and certainly never heard. This issue is not a small issue. It's about humanizing Natives. It's about allowing us to be seen for who we are. We are not mascots. We are the people who lived free and strong in this America until homelands were taken from us, our people persecuted and murdered, and our children denied access to their families, elders, and culture. From the very beginning, this country has had deliberate policies for destruction of indigenous peoples. Native children were forcibly taken to Indian residential schools as young as 4 and were required to stay until the age of 16 to 18 to ensure that they gave up their, quote, savage beliefs, unquote, and lost their connection to their family, community, and heritage. Thousands of Native children were abused and denied and died in those schools. They had the Indian beaten out of them while little white children enjoyed playing dress up and played Cowboys and Indians. We are known as American Indians, Native Americans, First Peoples, or Indigenous Peoples. We have survived the extermination attempts. We continue to experience the trauma of colonization, and we continue to believe that our ways, being one with the earth and nature, sustainability, and resilience should help lead us all toward a better world. We are a beautiful part of the fabric of the United States of America, as are all of our fellow brothers and sisters who experience systematic injustice. Mascots harm how we are perceived. Mascots harm the self-concept of our children. Mascots harm our integration into your culture. Mascots harm our futures, and mascots harm our children and yours. This is not about offense. This is about protecting our people from harm. This is about demanding that laws for equality against discrimination are reinforced to protect us. Throughout history, school boards have created and revised discrimination and harassment policies to protect all minorities. Native Americans are routinely ignored. Promotion of race-based Native mascotry keeps Natives as the only minority not protected under school board policies. All sports mascots manufactured by non-Indigenous people for non-Indigenous people are discriminatory, harmful, illegal, completely unnecessary, and easily remedied. Our nation must deny the institutional racism of sports mascots that leads many people to believe that these mascots are harmless. We are not mascots. No one is on the receiving end of publicly degrading sacrilegious caricatures but us, and no protected class of people in the Americas would permit similarly blatant discriminatory names and images to be forced into their eyes and ears day in and day out for decades. Impartial academic research is abundantly clear that mascots and stereotypes harm the targeted class of people, Indigenous peoples, with children being the most affected by negative consequences. Moreover, this same research suggests that any specific use of mascots and stereotypes crosses over and affects all protected classes because any demeaning of one class increases the context and perceptions of all targeted classes as to their social status and self-image, and increases the likelihood that the general population will view all classes of protected people with a lesser perception of equality. Thank you for your time today. Please consider being an ally to Native people. We are here and can use some support. See our website, Coalition of Natives and Allies, for ways we can help. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Donna. Our next hymn is number 707, Hymn of Promise. And our president-elect, that things, that people will become more united. I mean, when Jesus, the night he was betrayed, he prayed to the Father that we would all be one. And so I echo that today. We have such division in our nation that we really need to pray about that every day earnestly, that we can all come together as united people again. So let us come together now in prayer, recognizing brokenness suffered, wounds not yet healed, and our hope for peace and restoration. O Great Spirit, God of all people and every tribe, through whom all people are related, call us to the kinship of all your people. Grant us vision to see through the lens of justice the brokenness of the past. In your great love, O God, help us to listen to you and to one another in order to heal the wounds of the present. and give us courage, patience, and wisdom to work together for healing and hope with all of your people, now and in the future. In your great love, O God, mend the hoop of our hearts, and let us live in justice and peace. And now let us all join together with the Lord's Prayer. O great Spirit, you are our shepherd chief in the most high place, whose home is everywhere, even beyond the stars and moon. Whatever you want done, let it also be done everywhere. Give us your gift of bread day by day. Forgive us our wrongs as we forgive those who wrong us. Take us away from wrongful doings. Free us from all evil, for everything belongs to you. Let your power and glory shine forever. Amen. Now there, you'll find a special offering envelope in your bulletin for Native American Ministries. And you can leave that and any additional offerings in the basket. Is this the basket?
The offering plate over there.
Oh, the offering plate is over there. Okay. And now join me in the prayer of dedication and thanksgiving. We thank Great Spirit for the bounty of the earth. May the wholesomeness of the gifts of the earth bring out the wholesomeness of the Spirit within us. Amen. And our final hymn is number 428, for the healing of the nation.
About that on the way out. And now may God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. May God look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.